Philippians chapter 1. We as people live in this moment. We live in time. We are held to time. We are born in time, we live in time, and then we die in time. Everything in our existence is held to this concept of time. It's not really that way with God. God exists outside of the realm of time. He created time. But the problem is that because we live in time, sometimes we kind of have this idea that creeps up in our head that this moment is all that exists. You know what I mean? We get overly fixated on the problem that we face now. We get overly fixated on, you know, the thing that we're struggling with now. And we fail to see that things won't always be how they are now at this time. Because the only constant of time is that it's always changing. and sometimes we just don't really see how things really are. So here we're going to look at Paul tonight. After facing countless problems, Paul decides to go on another missionary trip, which will be his fourth, and which consists of imprisonment, shipwreck, and more fun. You know, he's has all kinds of fun stuff happen to him. Really just a good family vacation there. So he gets sent from Jerusalem, let's say the scenic route, to Rome. And why I say the scenic route is because there's a lot of stuff that happens. He's over here somewhere, and he decides, okay, I'm going to head back to Jerusalem, and they're trying to tell him, Paul, don't go back to Jerusalem, you're going to get arrested. And he says, I know it. And they say, please don't do this. And he says, stop trying to make me sad. I said I'm going to do it, just deal with it. Jeez, you're ruining my groove, man. Ever seen the Emperor's New Groove? You're throwing up a groove. So he gets arrested, just like the prophecies were given, just like he already knew was going to happen. And they ship him up through Sidon, up through here, Myra, and then through the Mediterranean Sea. Somewhere around here, they get lost. We obviously don't know exactly where they got lost because they were lost. It was the water. It all kinds of looks the same when you're out there. So after he does all this fun stuff, then he finally arrives in Rome, which is, you know, up here, and he spends another 2 years there in captivity. Now, at the end of these 2 years, Paul thought that this was it. He thought that he was going to die. He thought that this was kind of the end of the road. You know, he's faced countless problems. They stoned him a couple times. He was shipwrecked. I already mentioned that. Beaten, you know, outcast, all kinds of stuff, everything you can imagine going wrong. Well, that's what went wrong. I mean, there was even a coup trying to kill him, so he really wasn't the most popular guy, I guess, huh? He's not like Benny Hinn or something, you know, and people don't look at him and say, oh, I know this guy. They look at him and they say, oh, this guy, you know. you know, maybe Paul should have taken some pointers from Benny Hinn to figure out how to get people to stop trying to kill him. I'm just kidding. But anyways, so here he is in Rome, and he started thinking, oh, man, I guess this is the end of the road for me. Okay? So let's look at Philippians 1, 24. And I'm actually going to start a few verses before 24. I'll start in verse 21. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I am to live on in the flesh, this will mean fruitful labor for me. But I do not know what to choose. But I am hard-pressed from both directions, having the desire to depart and be with Christ, for that is very much better. Verse 24, yet to remain on in the flesh is more necessary for your sake. And then in verse 25, convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you for all your progress and joy in the faith. So here we have Paul kind of coming to grips with the situation that's happening. And, you know, he's gone through this time of really thinking that he's going to die, and yet here he is, still in Rome, still in imprisonment, and it seems like he caught some kind of a second wind or something. He thought, hey, maybe I'm not going to die. This thing's up in the air. I'm really not sure what's going on, and I don't know really what I want. You know, to die, that sounds pretty good, because then this stuff isn't going to be... Does anybody have arthritis? How fun is that? Well, Paul, you know, here he is in his 50s, 60s, probably getting a little bit sore from getting stoned and shipwrecked and all the kinds of other stuff, I just imagine. That sounds like something that's not real great on the joints. You know, I don't think that he wore, you know, Dr. Scholl's foot imprints. You know, I think that he was kind of just roughing it out there. So, year after year of struggles, now get this. Year after year of struggles, yet Philippians is, I dare say, the most hopeful book in the entire Bible. Here he is, thinking that he's getting ready to die. He's faced countless problems again and again and again. And instead of saying, I'm done with you, hoo-haws, I'm getting out of here, it's the most hopeful book in the entire Bible. Now that's saying something. That's saying a lot of something. Which brings me to my first point. During the struggle, there is more to do. When we get in struggles, we think that this moment is all there is. Because we're bound to time. We live in time. Everything is governed by time. But God is not governed by time. He exists outside of time. And he doesn't get stressed out because he's got all the time in the world. Because he made time. He can do whatever he wants. So during the struggle, there's still more to do. See, Paul could have said, you know what, I'm in this struggle, I've got nowhere to go, not even up. But he still chose to write a book. Well, what can I do, God? I'm just this guy that's having problems and all kinds of physical problems now. You know, I've got thorn in the flesh, whatever that is. And what can I do besides sit here and mope and whine? You can write a book that will be the most encouraging book in the entire Bible. Well, okay, that sounds like a start. So point number one that I want to get across, during your struggles, there's still more for God to have you do. We think that things steal our joy. I mean, how many times do you hear this? People steal your joy. A struggle steals your joy. Hey, if somebody makes you mad, just get away from them. You know, because things can steal your joy, right? If I just had all these problems go away, then I'd be happy. But Philippians shows us something entirely different. Struggles give opportunity to experience joy. Let me throw a hypothetical at you. Let's say you grow up in a house where your parents are rich. You never have a single problem in your life. I mean, everything's just smooth sailing. You never have health problems. Well, you're not really going to appreciate that very much, are you? Ever heard the story, what was it called, The Prince and the Pauper? I think that's what it's called. Kind of like that. See, we have all these struggles, and it helps us to realize the blessings that God brings by. Not only that, see, we want to be happy without growing. And that's not how things work. You can't be happy if you don't grow. See, when we first get saved, everything's fine. What's it called? Hunky-dory. Everything's hunky-dory. Okay, everything's great. Rainbows, butterflies. Awesome. Okay? Then after some time, we lose some of that joy, and all we have to do to get joy again is to pray and read our Bibles, and then we're happy again. And okay, so I'll just pray and read my Bible. But then after so long, that doesn't do it anymore. Why? Because God wants you to grow. He doesn't want you to stay where you are. All of a sudden, you'll find yourself not being happy until you go through trials and temptations. God, I don't want to do something like pastor or something like that because I don't want you to do something that, I don't want to be uncomfortable. I don't want to do something that I won't enjoy. What happens if by going through that is the only way that you will have true joy? That's exactly what the Bible says. We get joy by growth, and we get growth by facing those uncomfortable things. Well, that's a little bit of a hard thing for us to come to grips with. Is it possible to really know joy without struggle? That's an interesting question. I don't think it is. I don't think it is possible. So after preparing for death, get this. Now, here's a real surprise here. Paul is released. No, just go on. Goodness sakes. Paul is released from prison in Rome. Well, that was quite the turn of events. So he gets out of Rome and he goes down here and he goes on over to Crete, this little island right here. Okay, all right, then he heads on up here. And then he ends over here and he ends up going to Spain. Well, that was quite the turn of events. So that takes us to kind of a little bit more here. He went to places he'd never been, and he wrote at least three more books. 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and Titus. After that struggle that he thought was the end. I want to make sure everybody's getting what I'm saying, so I'll go back to this point here. Past the struggle, there is more to do. See, some of you are going through things that you will die struggling with. A lot, oftentimes we die struggling with health issues. Oftentimes, you know, God lets us do that. It's not fair, it's not fun, but hey, that's just what happens. Then there will be other things where you struggle for year after year, and you think that this is the end of the road, that God will never give you a happy day again, and then suddenly God brings you to something completely unexpected, and you do other things that you never even anticipated. See, not every struggle leads to death. Paul learned that. He thought that struggle led to death, but instead, it didn't. See, God had stuff for him to do in the struggle, but then God brought him out of the struggle and had him do more stuff. Now, what happened after that more stuff that God had him do? Well, he went back to Rome and he was killed. But once again, it's not about our leading, it's about God's leading. So past the struggles, there's more to do. You know, oftentimes we tell ourselves something along the lines of this: I never thought I'd ever make it through that struggle. I never thought that I'd ever see the end of it. And then, what do you know? God brings us to somewhere new. And I guess that brings us to this point here. Continue to look forward to what God has. Don't park your butt here and say, I'm done for. Because God has more for you. That's why I titled the sermon, what, more? Yes, more. Even if you never make it out of the struggle, look forward to what God has for you in the future. Because get this, God doesn't want you to spend the rest of your life sitting around complaining to him about how hard you had it earlier in your life. If you've been burned out in ministry, that sucks. I would know. I've experienced a lot of that. However, there is more to do, and there's more that God has for you. And in doing that, you find joy. In doing that, you find joy. There's a book I really like. Actually, it's a trilogy. It's called Lord of the Rings. They made it into a movie a couple years back. And the basic idea of this story is that there's this guy named Frodo, and he takes this ring to destroy it in this faraway land. Now, in the movie, they highlighted something that I greatly, greatly appreciate. And that's that Frodo never thinks that he's coming back. He thinks that he's going to die at the end of this journey. And yet, at the end of the movie, he's back home. He made it. He went there and back again. And that's kind of how God wants us to see our journey that he's bringing us through. Don't look at this as, God, this thing's going to kill me. I'm just not going to have any joy through it. But what if it doesn't kill you? What if God does have more for you? You won't know if you're not looking forward to, God, what do you have for me in tomorrow? I'll give you another two examples. Joe Flint, he's not here tonight. He's in California, but he had this heart surgery a couple years back, and I didn't think he was going to make it through, and he's still kicking. This has been years since the heart surgery. See, that heart surgery seemed like that was the final nail in the coffin, that was just going to be the end of the story, that I was going to have to say goodbye to someone, and then he pulled through. See, we look at everything with such finality and with such despair. Oh, God, you can never do something in this situation. Oh, God, you can never bring me through this. What's that old saying, never say never? Another example that I can give, I had agoraphobia so bad that I couldn't leave one room of my house. And it was a single wide house, single wide mobile home, so that's saying something. It was a tiny, tiny little place. And Albuquerque was kind of like my kryptonite. I couldn't sit 100 miles within that city. I've been to Albuquerque 2 times this year alone. See, sometimes we think that these struggles, they're going to destroy us and it's going to be the end of the road. But sometimes God doesn't want you to give up just yet. Sometimes he has more that he wants to do. Like Paul says here in Philippians, yet to remain on in the flesh is more necessary for your sake. It wasn't his time. And while we're waiting for eternity, let's look forward to what God has for us here. See, sometimes we kind of switch off, kind of just give up on things. Well, Jesus is going to return anyway, so I might as well just, you know, buckle down and wait for it. Well, what if God doesn't come for another 1,000 years? Well, let's work while we have the time to work. Let's not give up yet. When Jesus comes, then we'll give up because we won't be here anymore. But until then, let's focus on doing the work of the kingdom. So we're going to close out with one more passage. Philippians chapter 3, just two more chapters down. Verses 13 through 14, it says, brethren, I do not regard myself as having laid hold of it yet. But one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let's look forward. There in verse 13, I do not regard myself as having laid hold, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind, I press forward. I go forward. You'll notice that God doesn't have us go backwards to things. When Israel was leaving Egypt, he didn't say, hey, go back to Egypt. He said, press forward. So there's a few things. First off, you're alive, so God has more. Don't be one of those people who says, I'm too young or I'm too old. Don't be one of those people. Because, check it out, God has more for you. But I had this great disaster happen in my family. God has more. But I lost my job. God has more for you. See, don't reach a place of just giving up and saying, no, God, no, you can't lead me anywhere else. This struggle will be the death of me. But what if it isn't? Next, keep pushing forward. You don't know what tomorrow or even the rest of today holds. You don't know what tomorrow holds or even the rest of today. So, I mean, let's keep things in perspective here before you give up the fight too quickly. And the last thing, there's still more to do. And I think that Philippians is a perfect example of that. And so I have two things to say before we close out here. The first off is I'm giving you all homework. And I'm expecting you to do it. We have hall monitors. They will be keeping tabs on you. The first thing I would greatly appreciate for you to do, I am officially asking you to do this. Read through Philippians. That is me, as your friend, asking you to please read through Philippians. And the second thing that I'm asking you to do, look forward to what else God has for you to do. What else does God have for you to do? Look forward. Don't keep your eyes back there. There's nothing back there. Keep your eyes forward. Okay? So we're going to close out in prayer. Remember, what were you two things I asked you to do? And? No. There you go. Look forward. Negative points for Ann. See, he's already in like a B. You guys are in A, right? See, Ann's an A-plus student. You guys better hang out with her. Can I have Chuck close us out in prayer, please?
Father God, we thank you for your word, and we pray that it will not be something that goes in one ear and out the other, but Lord, that we will take it, we will meditate on it, and that we will apply it to our lives, and that we will use it for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
And Kirk, would you mind...